Hey there, Scott Wilkinson here at CEDIA Expo 2013. I'm talking with David Abrams, a calibrator from Southern California, who came to the show to see what he could see. So, David, what has tickled your fancy so far?
Well, coming from the video side, there's been a number of very interesting things that have come out. One of the things Display Development is now distributing or selling their own version of the Christie projectors. They're not hiding
kind of
that.
Rebranded. Yeah, they're not hiding it.
They're not
it
even
at all.
Rebranding it. They're saying we're doing our tweaks. They have custom aperture plates for the cinema line so that you can get it down on a smaller screen. Custom gamma curves for some of their other lines to try and get a more accurate picture, better for the, more accurate at least in the home theater environment versus that 50-foot screen. So that was very interesting. DPI, of course, has their LED projector.
The Titan LED.
The Titan LED.
We saw that yesterday and found out, we noticed immediately, both Mark and I, that the color gamut is way outside of Rec. 709.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
You noticed that too, I'm sure.
Yep, and they were saying, during the demo, we're showing it wide color gamut to show you the potential of the color gamut of this projector. We realize it's not quite hitting the spec right now, but you can calibrate it to the spec and create that memory on there. But it was very interesting that they've got a very big projector that's quiet, that can do a larger screen, but with LEDs being quieter, and then running, they're actually running six LEDs. They're running two red, two green, two blue in order to get the brightness, and then are liquid cooling that. So they've got some really interesting stuff coming out there.
Right, and it certainly is a lot brighter than any of the other LEDs projectors
yeah.
you've seen.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely yeah. A lot brighter. So,
but it's also, what, $80,000?
Yeah, when they told me that, I was like, $80,000? Okay. I'm probably not going to have one in my living room, but it is a unique concept. And of course, for those rooms, where you have the projector over the person's head, or you don't have a soffit, you can't really put a sound box around it necessarily, it may be a very good fit.
Yeah, liquid cooled and very quiet, runs cool to begin with.
Sure.
And no fans.
I'm not sure if they don't have any fans, but
fewer anyway.
Certainly lower, but they might not have any fans. So that was certainly interesting.
Yeah.
And then, of course, HDMI 2.0 and 4K is the buzz of the show.
It's the buzz of the show. And, I find it very interesting that 4K and HDMI 2.0 is the buzz of the show, but there isn't that much in the way of 4K displays. That Titan is 1080p.
Yep.
The Christie, the display development Christie is 4K.
Yes.
Sony has a 4K, but Epson doesn't.
Yeah.
JVC... sort of does, but not really.
Yep. Well, anywhere from the DLP technology, there's not going to be 4K in the consumer world, really, because TI is not selling chips outside of the cinema vendors. So they're trying to keep it to digital cinema for whatever reason, licensing agreements, however they've worked that out. That's coming down the road is what everyone keeps saying is, oh yeah, we're going to have 4K DLP soon. We're going to have it soon. Just keep holding out for 4K DLP. But of course...
But for now, if you want it, you got to buy a digital cinema projector the Christie.
Yep, like the Christie, which Display Development, of course, is got out there. And then, of course, if you want 4K from other vendors, the LCDs, the SXRD technologies, you've got Sony.
And
Sony's got their new line, right? I think I didn't catch all the pricing, but I think they have a 4K now at $15,000
retail. $15,000,
exactly.
Yeah. It's the VPL VW600ES,
yep.
Which is a lower cost than their 1000, which was their first 4K. And the interesting thing about that is that the 1000 was incompatible with their server, their 4K yep. Hatbox server. The 600 is compatible with it, and Sony is offering an upgrade to the 1100, which is also compatible.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Nice. And I saw that 1100. Is that going to be the same price as the 1000 was, the $25,000 retail?
I'm not 100% sure.
Okay.
Roughly. It'll be in the same ballpark, which is like 25 grand.
But still, 4K at $15,000 from Sony,
it's pretty
that's
nice.
Pretty good.
And have you seen that demo yet?
I have not.
Okay,
have
you
not.
Should. It has a long line,
it's
and
got
for
a
good
line.
Reason.
It's got a long
we
maybe
actually
right
got to
after.
See it. And they showed two things. They showed real 4K content, native 4K content, and then upscale.
Okay.
And the native 4K content looked really good. I thought it looked fabulous.
Okay.
And the upscaled stuff looked good, too. So
sure. We're
getting into a price point area here where
sure. It's
going to be useful, accessible, attainable.
To many.
To many. Yeah, not everybody.
Even on a small home theater scale, you're going to be able to get 4K, and you're going to be able to get that.
And the content from their server.
Yes, and the content from their server. So that's very interesting. And then I guess the other interesting thing is the whole HDMI. The whole HDMI story.
What's your hit on HDMI 2.0?
Well, the word around here, the HDMI group and stuff, people that are a part of it have basically stated, you know, the current stuff that's upgradable to HDMI 2.0 is really upgradable, and it'll support certain parts of it. If it supports one thing that's part of the HDMI 2.0 spec, they can say, we're upgradable to 2.0. We're supporting this 2.0 feature, and therefore we're 2.0.
Right.
So a lot of the companies that have displays currently on the market are using the current HDMI chipsets, which, you know, that's all you can ask for, right? They're using the state-of-the-art chipsets that are out there right now.
Right. 2.0 has only been ratified or finalized for, what, a month or two?
Sure.
So no one's built chips yet.
That's right. So what they're using is current chips that are capable of handling some of the 2.0 features, but not necessarily everything. And
right.
So one of the things that's come to the attention from a number of manufacturers around here that make HDMI products is they won't be able to do 4K 60 with the current chips at 422 or 444.
Which is a color compression.
Yeah, color space formats.
Color space formats.
Sure. So, but they can do 420, which is, again, a form of compression. That's what's on your Blu-ray disc, your DVD is 420. But ultimately, it gets converted, right? It gets decompressed to either 422, 444, or RGB out of the player. And so right now, I've asked a lot of people, like, well, what's out there that's going to output 420? And there's not really any formats outputting 420. There's formats that are 420, like a Blu-ray, but no player outputs 420.
Right.
So if you want to watch something like 4K 60 on a current display when it gets upgraded to that HDMI 2.0,
quote unquote,
you won't be able to do those higher frame rates. You'll be able to do the 4K at 24, which is, you know, movies, right? So most movies will work.
Right. But video won't. So if they're shooting sports at 4K, for example, in video, you're not going to be able to see all of that.
They may run into some issues. You know, you could get a really expensive scaler that might do some fancy frame rate conversion and make it acceptable, but then you're spending money there. So the general consensus seems to be sometime next year we'll see newer chipsets, newer technology, and we'll start to see those higher bandwidths being supported, which is exciting. I mean, it's exciting that we are going to the higher resolution. The whole system's falling into place, right? You always have something new. You know, we had HDTV, but we only had broadcast HDTV. There were no formats for HDTV.
Right.
And we didn't even have 1080p. We only had 1080i. And so it's sort of like that with HDMI right now. It's like, we've got some 4K TVs, not really any content to the consumer yet, but that's all starting to come, and then the formats to handle that are starting to fall into place, and maybe another year or so we're going to see that all very quickly. Oh, now you've got a player that can do it. Now you've got a receiver that can pass it. Now you've got a scaler that can do it. Now you can have a TV that can run it. So,
The display side of things seems to be moving along more quickly than anything else.
Oh, yeah.
You know, because you've got LG just announced two more 4K Ultra HD sets, edge lit rather than backlit.
Okay.
For less money. I mean, the 55 inch is $3,500.
$3,500.
Yeah.
Man, see, not selling stuff, I stay so far away from price. Wow, that's a good price.
It seems to me
that's
to
a
be.
Good price.
And then you've got the cheap Chinese companies, Seiki and TCL and Hisense, are going to come out with really inexpensive ones that are probably not going to be that good.
We'll have to see.
We'll see at CES, won't we?
We will see at CES.
Let's hope so. So I want to make sure to let everybody know that your company, Avical, you're based in L.A., but you can travel anywhere, and you calibrate all kinds of displays.
All kinds of displays, from broadcast studios, we do a lot of edit-based, our color suites, screening rooms, to high-end home theater, to plasma TVs in people's living rooms. So
Now, have you done any calibrating work here at the show?
Not here at the show. No, not this
year. You often do. So
sometimes, sometimes.
You weren't
not
called upon
this
year to do it.
No.
So you're just a freelancer. You're hanging around. You're looking for what you can see and what's cool.
I want to check out all the cool toys. I want to see what I'm going to be working on. You know?
Yeah. Exactly. Next year.
That's right.
Cool, man. Thanks so much for being here.
All right. Well, thank you.
All right.